Welcome, everybody, to Path to Recovery. I'm April Chapman Thomas, and today I'm talking with Christian Hemlick with OWA in Foley, Alabama. Christian, before we begin, can you tell us a little about OWA?
Sure. OWA is a 520-acre destination resort. We're located in Foley, Alabama, which is about 10 minutes north of Gulf Shores in Orange Beach, along Alabama's beautiful Gulf Coast. So we are a large resort with an amusement park, a downtown with shopping, dining, and live entertainment, and a hotel here on property.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Tell us a little bit about, I guess, the process from closing to reopening it, because your closing was a little unusual. Didn't the park have to close completely, but downtown still had pickup?
Right. Yeah, it definitely was a unique experience as, you know, COVID first began. So our amusement park was required to close on March the 17th just due to the governor's orders. We actually elected to close 2 weeks earlier than when the governor put closure orders first or forth. And that was just out of the health and safety of our guests and our employees. So the amusement park closed March the 17th. And so did our live entertainment venues, which was Legends in Concert and Brandon Styles Live. So those are two indoor theater type venues we have here on property. So although those places closed, we did have our restaurants and our retailers and our hotel that remained open. And so as the governor of Alabama continued to issue additional orders for closure, we did experience, you know, kind of a phased closing. The retailers were the next affected, and then restaurants as well. And so our restaurants in downtown, they did try to, even though their storefronts were closed to the public, they did try to do the deliveries and do the to-go orders, but it just became challenging because we're in a tourist destination, and you know, it did become challenging from an employment standpoint to keep the employees, you know, busy enough with orders coming in. And so there was a period that all of downtown and the park decided to close, and that happened in April. And the hotel did remain open during this period of time. They stayed open the whole time, but they did elect to close the other businesses for several weeks. So, you know, that process was, it was interesting for us all, but luckily around the middle of April, once the governor started releasing some of the stay-at-home orders and authorizing businesses to reopen, we got downtown open as quick as possible, and then everything's kind of fallen into place since then.
What a interesting time. This is something you're really not prepared for and kind of have to do it by the seat of your pants. What were employees doing at this time?
So we actually, you know, there's quite a few employees here on property, from anything from restaurant workers to retail employees to those who operate rides in our amusement park. So while the amusement park closed, many of our employees, like the ride operators and, you know, guest services, we use that time to be able to train them on, you know, best practices, talk about what our reopening looked like, and start drafting plans up. So that was a great time for us to really, you know, invest in, you know, training and education for the employees. It was also a good time for us to work on some maintenance and upkeep for the park. We had a very busy start to spring break, which actually began in late February, and so, you know, went into the middle of March. And so we were able to make some tweaks and adjustments here as far as operations goes. And so it was, we did have the ability to keep them working through about, I would say, the middle of April. And then some of our full-time employees did remote work from home. So that was interesting for us all, was we had, you know, Zoom meetings like this with dogs and cats and kids in the background, but we all made the best of it and, you know, really focused on strong reopening plans for the park and making sure that we were using the best practices for health and safety that's not just based on what's here in the state of Alabama, but more international standards in the amusement park industry.
Talk about your advertising during this time. How did it have to adjust or fluctuate?
Sure. So advertising definitely adjusted. You know, initially when the park closed, we shifted all of the advertising. It was focused on the amusement park. That was a huge draw in our live entertainment. We did have to shift and kind of restructure to focus on our restaurants and our retailers. And that was really our main goal, was to help drive business and awareness to the public that these businesses could service you, whether it was curbside to go or delivery. So that was a huge focus. So when the resort closed all the way, that presented a whole new challenge for us, because we wanted to make sure we were keeping, you know, consumers engaged with the brand. And so what we looked at were unique ways to reach the consumers. And we actually took one of our very popular kind of field trips that we do for school that's called Education in Motion. And we had employees recreate that through a video and have lessons that could be downloaded off of our website. So that was kind of an at-home teachable moment that parents could do with kids. We did a lot of other contests and games and just different ways to interact with the public to keep them motivated. One of my other favorite activities that we kind of continued on throughout that time was weekly contests for people to share their favorite moments at OWA. And we had different themes each week, whether it was Christmas or fall or a summer memory or a favorite ride. It was great to see, you know, guests from all over the United States participate and share videos and photos. And then we were able to select by the public's choice the favorites of the week, and those individuals were able to receive season passes. So it was a great way to keep the public engaged and also a nice way to keep people around the dinner table talking about OWA.
Excellent. And tell us a little bit about the reopening. It's done in phases, correct? Yes. I believe the live entertainment doesn't reopen until July.
That's right. So it has been in phases. It started, I would say it was around the middle of April. The days all kind of run together now. It feels like it's been years this has been going on, but I know it's only been a few short months. But it was about middle April that we were able to begin reopening, and retail was actually the first to allow guests back into the stores. They reopened at a reduced capacity, and so we initially started marketing and advertising the retail stores being open, and again, being conscious of what, you know, the public was saying and monitoring a lot of the trends online. You know, we knew people were not 100% confident coming out to shop in a store. So a lot of our retailers offered online, you know, order placement, deliveries, and things of that nature just to kind of meet the customer's needs. So we had about 2 weeks of focusing on retail. And then once we hit that hump, the next group was the restaurants that started opening. And they were also opening at 50% capacity. So we started shifting our marketing and advertising over to promote the restaurants and, you know, really the health and safety practices that have been put in place and implemented on the property have been the overall theme that we have started with from the retail stores and carried that through. And then in early June, we were finally able to get the amusement park open. It was a process to get to that space, and we worked with the governor's office as well as some of our local elected officials and like Senator Chris Elliott and several others to help us get to a place that, you know, the leadership felt comfortable with us opening. So that was the next phase, and it was interesting getting the amusement park open. All of our employees are required to wear masks when they interact with the guest. We also have health and safety checks at the initial entrance before anyone's allowed into the amusement park, which means that you get your temperature taken and you're asked a series of questions. And based on your temperature reading and your answer to those questions will determine if you're allowed entry into the park. I will say that it has been very well received by the public. They have really appreciated the steps that we've taken and the increased like sanitization practices and wearing the mask and the health checks. And they definitely have a sense of comfort when they come out. And then this most recent group that we're reopening now is our entertainment venues with Legends and Concerts set to open on July 1st. So it'll be our next business to get open. And luckily, once they're open, everything is 100%. So we're very excited to get back to a little sense of normalcy.
Aren't we all though?
Yes.
Well, looking back, what do you wish you knew then that you knew now?
That's a great question. You know, I think that looking back at the very beginning, I think that our team, we have a very small marketing and PR team here, and then we work with some outside agency partners. You know, I think that finding ways to gather information, it was coming so quick and fast. I think that is probably the part that is that was the most challenging then and still remains the most challenging now is the unknown. I mean, that really has been something that day by day we come in and we meet as a leadership team and we talk about, you know, what's trending in the local area, what's trending in the region nationally and internationally. And really try to understand, like, how do we fit our marketing message and how do we fit our, you know, strategy going forward into the new kind of world we're in. And, you know, for a marketer, we plan these things out months and months in advance. And I was, you know, in many meetings, we say, well, you know, we're not sure what we can plan for the fall or the winter yet. So I think that's probably been our biggest challenge. And, you know, looking back, it would have been great for us to have a crystal ball to be able to say, okay, this is when we think this is going to end, or this is when we think that, you know, we can come back to a little bit of a normal daily operations. But it definitely has been an interesting challenge for sure.
What advice would you give others?
I think the biggest advice that I would give is to not stop doing what you did during the shutdown, during this new kind of operation period. And I tell my team that every day, you know, during the closure, when our marketing team was working remotely, we spent a lot of time on educating ourselves and researching, you know, kind of what consumer trends are, consumer sentiment. We plugged into a lot of webinars and Zoom meetings and just really tried to connect more with colleagues that we probably never committed the right amount of time to in the past. And so one of the things that I continue to, you know, reiterate to my team is that all of those unique ideas that we had about connecting with guests online and, you know, doing these video experiences for field trips and things of that nature, don't stop looking at those new ideas, because that's kind of the direction I feel like, you know, our consumers are going. The, you know, internet, social media, that absolutely, social media has been a huge tool for us to be able to communicate when we haven't been able to advertise in other mediums. And I definitely feel like that's going to continue to be the future for our property. And I would say that as, you know, you go in forward, just make sure that you're spending time every week trying to keep up with the pulse of what's happening in the world and trying to educate yourself and stay informed on tourism and travel.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it.
You're most welcome. Thank you, April.
Thank you.